I need thee every hour. After we came to Jesus and made a full surrender to him of our will and took up our cross to follow him, he has become our advocate with the Father, and we received the beginning of the Holy Spirit and became children of God. Then came the lesson of this hymn. The Christian undertakes a great contract in his engagement to be loyal to the will of God at the sacrifice of his own will in every affair of life. If he starts out with a spirit of self-confidence, he is very likely to have a rude awakening as respects his own weaknesses and imperfections. He will find that, as Jesus said, without me, ye can do nothing. He will find himself beset with trials and difficulties and needing assistance and succor. Then it is that listening to the voice of the Savior through the Bible, he hears the precious message, I will never leave thee nor forsake thee. And again, lo, I am with you always, even to the end of the age. Thus all the children of God are drawn to their great Savior, who is also their great teacher and king, under whose supervision they are being fitted to be kings and priests and judges during the 1,000 years of Messiah's kingdom. In the course of life, the adversary and our own flesh, through its inherited weaknesses, bring temptations to us as new creatures, temptations to be less careful as respects sin, as respects disloyalty to the Lord and to the truth. But as this precious hymn points out, all such temptations lose their power when we are living near to our Lord, when we realize his presence with us as our daily companion, when we can by faith look up into his face and realize that all the good promises of the Bible are ours through him. In our joys we need the Lord, else they might soon intoxicate us, and we will become possessed of the worldly spirit. Wise are the children of God who refuse to seek pleasure, joy, entertainment, anywhere that their Lord, their Redeemer, could not be their companion. And surely also these will meet him in the hour of fire, in the hour of pain and sickness and sorrow, as their comforter, as their sympathizing friend above all others. Truly to the Lord's people who have entered the new life and are walking with the Master, life would seem a vain thing without the companionship of their heavenly Lord. We need the Lord as our teacher. We need to watch his footsteps and walk in them, and to note how he followed not his own will, but the Father's will, that we may thus, following his example, have the right to claim the rich promises of God's word, which assure us that if we are faithful in walking with the Savior, we shall ultimately share his glory, in his honor, and in his immortality. In the sweet by and by, the sentiment of this beautiful hymn is generally appreciated. All who love righteousness, whether they have become sons of God or not, seem to enter heartily into the singing of this beautiful hymn. It seems to answer an expectation of the soul. When we think of the Heavenly Father as a great God, we are bound to think of him as a gracious God, a sympathetic God. For a being devoid of justice, mercy, and love could not be great, whether human or divine. And this being contradicts all the creeds that we have ever known and professed to believe. According to our creed, which we no longer believe and should no longer profess, the only reunion on eternity's shore for the families of earth would be an eternal torture. We have in this talk, in contradiction to the Bible, that the present life determines for every member of Adam's race whether he will spend an eternity in happiness or an eternity in misery. The same creeds tell us that the only ones God will accept and who will be happy in eternity are the saints. And these, we all know, are very few indeed anywhere. The masses have never made their peace with God, never consecrated their lives to God through Christ, and become sons of God by the begetting of the Holy Spirit. How glad we are to find that the creeds are in error, that our uncles and aunts and cousins and neighbors, our brothers and sisters, our parents and children, and the heathen who fail to come into heart relationship to the Lord before dying, are not in consequence suffering an eternity of torture. According to the Bible, and this beautiful hymn expresses it, they are dead. Not dead by the brute, but asleep in death, awaiting the millennial morning when Christ, after establishing his church with himself in kingdom glory and power, will bless the living generation and for his begin the work of awakening the sleepers from the tomb. A proper appreciation of the Bible teaching on this subject is an inspiration to Christians and an attraction to all mankind. The Bible, which tells of the glorious millennial day of 1,000 years provided for our race through the Redeemer, with the opportunity for eternal life, becomes an interesting book. The God whose plan is thus revealed to the fearful eyes of the dawning creation is a glorious God, abundant in mercy, one whom all can reverence and honor, and to whom they feel disposed to draw near. The thought that there is to be a sweet by and by, a meeting on eternity's shore, puts an incentive into life. It is something to live for.
I've found a friend. We are all more or less dependent. None is complete in himself. To crave fellowship, friendship, cooperation, assistance, and are generally willing to render these aids to others, that we may receive also from them. To imagine oneself as absolutely friendless in a selfish world would send a chill through almost any heart. And yet there are some who are in this distressing condition, friendless. Perhaps it is because they are not themselves friendly or obliging or kind. Or it may be through their loyalty to what they believe to be principles of righteousness that they have alienated the friendship of the world. Christians, in the latter case, are instructed by their master to rejoice. If the world hates you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. If ye were of the world would love his own. But because ye are not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hateth you. Blessed are they which are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are ye when men shall revile you and persecute you, and shall say all manner of evil against you falsely for my sake. Rejoice and be exceeding glad, for great is your reward in heaven. But the hatred of the world, the misunderstanding of our friends, and the consequent unfriendliness of those about us, cannot well be borne unless they have attained the glorious condition described in this hymn. I have found a friend, oh, such a friend. He loved me ere I knew him. He drew me with the cords of love, and thus he bound me to it. To have the Lord Jesus as our friend means, oh, so much. We dare lose the friendship of the whole world and incur the enmity of all mankind by faithfulness to righteousness and truth, because these experiences would only draw us nearer to our great heavenly friend, who has attested his love by the sacrifice of himself. And whoever is thus bound to Jesus by the ties of friendship and the cords of love is also bound for the same to the Heavenly Father. The Master himself declared as such, the Father himself loveth you. And let us not forget that we were not drawn to the Savior through fear of him, but by the cords of love. A great mistake was made in the theological creeds of the past, and fear was used as a lash to drive mankind to religion. How foolish, how contrary to the Bible, which declares, the love of Christ constraineth us. And again, perfect love casteth out fear. Jesus, lover of my soul. Some years after the close of the American Civil War, an excursion party was steaming down Chesapeake Bay. A Christian man on board, of splendid voice, was asked to sing for the entertainment of the party. He chose this hymn, rendering it with great pathos. As he finished, the gentleman in the audience elbowed his way toward the singer and asked, "Neighbor, were you in the Civil War?" "Yes," was the reply. "I was on the Union side." "Were you in such a battle, and did you remember the night before?" The answer was, "Yes, I remember it well. It was a dark night, and the battle was expected the next day. I had written my farewell home. I was assigned to picket duty, and was feeling extremely sad and burdened of soul. I remember that as I walked on sentry duty, I sang this hymn, Jesus, lover of my soul, let me to thy bosom fly." "Well, stranger," said the other, I remember that night, too. I heard you sing that hymn. It made a deep impression upon me. I knew your voice when I heard it just now. I was on the southern side. I had you covered with my rifle and was about to shoot you. But stranger, as you sang, cover my defenseless head with the shadow of thy wings, a power came over me which I could not resist, and I did not shoot you. Humanly speaking, your singing that hymn saved your life. There may be times when the Christian seems to be at a disadvantage, viewed from the standpoint of the world. His covenant of consecration to the Lord and his righteousness, his service, seem at times to deprive the Christian of opportunities, privileges, and pleasures which others enjoy. However, it surely will be the testimony of all mature Christians that the sacrifices which their consecration vows involve are as nothing when compared to their joys and privileges and blessings as children of God, followers of Jesus. There are times of stress in the affairs of all when they need the refuge, the protecting care of heaven, and none but Christians have this protecting care. None but they have the divine assurance that all things will be supervised and overruled for their welfare. None but they, therefore, can rejoice in tribulation. During this gospel age, only consecrated believers in Jesus are received into God's family. Only these may look up and cry, Abba, Father, and sing, cover my defenseless head with the shadow of thy wings. Nothing can come to them that will not be for their highest interest. Glad tidings of great joy. This inspiring hymn sends our minds back to the words of the angels who announced the shepherds on the plains of Bethlehem the birth of Jesus, saying, Behold, we bring you good tidings of great joy which shall be to all people. The birth of Jesus, while not the beginning of divine interest in man, was the first manifestation to him of God's love and sympathy. Mankind needed first to learn the lessons of divine justice and divine power, and that these will be exercised in the punishment of sin. Of divine love we read, in this was manifested the love of God toward us, because God sent his only begotten Son into the world that we might live through him. Not all have learned the relationship between the birth of Jesus, his earthly life, his crucifixion, and the future glorious outworking of God's love for our race. What our Lord Jesus did at his first advent was merely a preliminary work, important, necessary, because only by the cancellation of the death penalty could the sinner be recovered. As it was a perfect man that sinned and came under the death penalty, so the Redeemer must be a perfect man to die as a just for the unjust. The death of Jesus is the basis upon which the millennial kingdom will be established. His death constitutes the purchase price for the whole world of mankind, because of which the world is to be turned over to him, that he may reign 1,000 years in heavenly glory and power for the uplift, the restitution to perfection of Adam and his race, for whom he died more than 18 centuries ago. Do we inquire of why the long delay between the giving of the ransom price and the taking over the purchase possession? The Bible answers that another part of God's plan was meanwhile to be developed, the selection of the church. Throughout the past 18 centuries, God, through Christ, has been merely calling a saintly little flock out from the world to be put as followers of Jesus. He has not been attempting the conversion of the world during this age, hence it still lies in the wicked one. The church, the called ones, become eventually by a share in the first resurrection, Christ's bride class in glory, honor, and immortality. This faithful company have the Master's promise that if they suffer with him, they shall also reign with him in his kingdom. It is the inauguration of Messiah's kingdom when the church will be with him in glory, of which we sing in this hymn. Joy to the world, it surely will be, and joy to the soul, the wonders of God's love. But not until the joys of the church have first been perfected. Lead kindly life. This beautiful hymn appeals to human hearts everywhere. It comes to us from a Roman Catholic, Cardinal Newman. It appeals to all because it touches the sympathetic chord of human experience. All feel their need of the kindly light of heaven. All realize that life's way has been a dark one because of the encircling gloom from our erroneous creed. Satan, the prince of darkness, has been ruler of this world for long centuries, not through divine appointment or authority, but through deception. Taking advantage of human weakness and ignorance, he works in the hearts of the children of disobedience, who are vastly in the majority. God's children, the children of light, are but a little flock to whom, with Jesus, it is the Father's good pleasure to give the millennial kingdom. The blessings of Messiah's kingdom are pictured as the rising of the Son of Righteousness with healing in his being. Jesus taught that this Son of Righteousness represents himself and his faithful little flock in their glory of the kingdom. They are to be enthroned in glory and power. Then the light of the knowledge of the glory of God shall fill the whole earth until every knee shall bow. For all who refuse obedience under the blessings and opportunities of that kingdom will well deserve the second death of utter destruction which the Bible teaches. The Lord's instruction to the church was that we should walk in the light, but instead creed making was started in A.D. 325, and Bible study was completely shut off for more than 12 centuries. And even when Bible study began to revive, God's people were handicapped by the false doctrines, the doctrines of the men of the darker times, and we are scarcely out of the fog yet. Like the cardinal, we have all realized an encircling gloom. What was taught us did not seem godlike or reasonable. It conflicted with both our heads and our hearts to believe that practically everybody, all except the saintly few, must spend an eternity in devilish torture. We no longer believe this, but alas, many who have rejected it are still outwardly professing it to the continued dishonor of God's name, the searing of their consciences, and the blighting of their kingdom prospects. Instead of stepping out from what they have ceased to believe, these remain in feudal bondages because their financial and social interests are bound up in the great systems connected with those creeds. Only God knows to what extent these realize the hypocrisy of their position. But surely, to whatever extent untruth is supported, the individual must fail to have the Lord's full love and approval. He that is ashamed of me and of my words, of him will I be ashamed, said Jesus. Like the sound of many waters, in this beautiful pictorial language, the Lord indicates how the knowledge of his goodness and mercy and love shall eventually reach the entire human family, and what the response will be. Like the sound of many waters, yea, and thunder, saying, Alleluia, Lord, Lord Almighty. It is a picture of the future, not of the present. But thank God it is the near future. Preceding verses picture the end of the present order of things, with the fall of Babylon the Great, and the ushering in of the new condition under Messiah's kingdom. For as verse 7 explains, the marriage of the Lamb will have come. The church will have all passed beyond the veil to be forever with the Lord, to share in the glories of his kingdom. Some of those representatives singing for joy and shouting hallelujah and hailing the kingdom of God to come will doubtless experience a major disappointment, having expected that they would have been in the kingdom class themselves, but having failed to walk in the footsteps of Jesus. However, so grand will be the new condition of things that everybody will be rejoicing. Everybody will be glad that God will have terminated the reign of sin and death. Even though its full will be in a most terrible time of trouble, the worst the world has ever known. But we can endure much when we know of blessings to follow. The Alleluia shout will be like the sound of many waters, many people, and it is mentioned. It is the Lord God omnipotent reigneth. For 6,000 years, ever since Father Adam rebelled against his Creator's laws and came under the death sentence, The Lord God Omnipotent has not been reigning on earth. It has been a rebellious province. However, as Jesus taught us to pray, Our Father, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth even as in heaven, so the entire Bible teaches us that Messiah's kingdom will be the reestablishment of the reign of Jehovah, because Messiah will be the great mediatorial representative of Jehovah's kingdom. This will be the end of the reign of sin and death, the binding of Satan, the beginning of the reign of righteousness. No wonder that all coming to understand things properly will shout hallelujah. No wonder the Bible declares that the coming of Messiah's kingdom will be the attainment of the desire of all nations. Hallelujah. What a Savior, able to save unto the uttermost all that come to the Father through him. The church in the present age, and all the willing and obedient of mankind in the coming age, the millennium. Love divine, all love excelling. Instinctively we have felt what the Bible so clearly teaches, namely, that God is love. Our hearts were nearer right than our dreams. The priest told us that God was all wise and knew the end from the beginning and purpose whatsoever comes to pass. To this we still agree, but we object to their statement of God's purpose that nearly every member of the human family is to be eternally tortured by fireproof devils in some place of unknown locality called hell. All the heathen were to be tortured because they had not known of the only name under heaven given amongst men whereby they must be saved. All the Jews in Jesus' day were to be tortured because they had not believed on him. Nearly all the people of Christian lands as well were to be tortured because they had not consecrated their lives to Jesus and become saints. As the Reverend Dr. Jonathan Edwards put it, the saintly few were to go to heaven and look over its battlements at the millions of heathen and civilized, including their own brothers and sisters, parents, husbands, wives, neighbors, etc., suffering the tortures of the damned, and were then turned round and praised God the louder because they had escaped such a devilish fate. Is it any wonder that we should have difficulty in understanding how God could be just and wise, powerful and loving, and yet foreknow and foreordain such a diabolical plan? Is it any wonder that people try to put God from their minds and were disinclined to search the scriptures which they taught such terrible doctrine? It is not strange that some one in society to keep from thinking about the future, and that others see themselves the theater going, the novel reading, the dreaming, the drinking and carousing, the pleasure or the amassing wealth, the frightful erroneous thoughts of the future. Evidently, with the best of intentions, we who are Christians have been doing harm where we wish to do good. St. Paul explains that these false doctrines which have so bewildered us are doctrines of devils. He prophesied how they would overspread the church, taking the place of the true faith. A Sunday school superintendent asked the infant class what they would do when they got to heaven. A little girl held up her hand. "What is your answer, Dennis?" she inquired. The child replied, "I would run and get behind Jesus so God would not see me." Alas, that he told his taught our children that they would steal their best friend, the Heavenly Father, the one who plans the entire program of salvation and whose prepositions will build the Messiah's kingdom. Many sleep, but not forever. This comforting theme is in full accord with the entire teaching of the Bible. Thus we read, Abraham was gathered to his father, and they were heathen. We read also the prophets, judges, and kings, good and bad. They were gathered to their fathers. They slept with their fathers. In the New Testament, we read the same. Jesus said of Jairus' daughter and of Lazarus of Bethany that they were sleeping. Their awakening was an illustration of the great divine power operating in Jesus, which during the millennial age will awaken all the sleepers from death. The Bible tells that the church only will have a share in the first resurrection, and that it will be the best, the superior one, to the spirit plane of glory, honor, and immortality. The kingdom power will then be put into operation, and all the living generations will be brought to the knowledge of the Lord. A little later, the sleeping ones will begin to be awakened. All who have ever lived will come back from the tomb. This the Bible is simply teaching. Then Paul declares that without the resurrection, there shall be no future life. The penalty which came upon Father Adam and his race was a death penalty, not a penalty of eternal torture, as we once supposed when we neglected the study of our Bible and believed the false doctrines of our creed made during the Dark Ages. Reading the account in Genesis 3:17-19, we notice how plainly the matter is stated. But God never designed that man should die hopelessly. On the contrary, he purposed a redemption and restoration which will be carried out to the very letter. In the divine purpose, Jesus was the Lamb of God slain from before the foundation of the world as the Redeemer of our race. Because of God's purpose to redeem the race and awaken them, he everywhere speaks of the dead as being asleep. Note the plain statement, as by man, Adam, came death, by a man also, Jesus, comes the resurrection of the dead. How the truth on this subject gladdens our hearts. What a grief it caused us. What an encircling gloom to think of the heathen as suffering tortures, and to think of our neighbors, friends, relatives as in danger of the same fate. The Bible assures us that the sleeping ones are entirely unconscious, and that when awakened in the resurrection morn, their first thought will connect up with the last thought they have when they die. What a great blessing will come to the world to be awakened to the Messiah's kingdom and to enjoy all its blessings of knowledge and of opportunity to rise up from sin and death to perfection in the image of God. The church's resurrection will be in the coming, but the world's resurrection will not be finished until the end of the millennium. Nearer, my God, to thee. One might suppose that a hymn containing so much very serious thought as this one would be appreciated by comparatively few, only by the faithless. But it seems otherwise. It is sung heartily, both by saints and sinners, in churches, in rooms, everywhere. Man is so constituted by nature that he instinctively longs for fellowship with his God. Phrenology explains that the basest passions and appetites lie along the base of the brain, and that the superior and higher aptitudes of the mind occupy the top of the brain. It is undoubtedly true that the majority of people live deeply in the cellar or base of their brain. Their words, deeds, and thoughts have to do with the sensual rather than with the intellectual and spiritual. Doubtless many remain in such a condition because of ignorance, superstition, and fear. They've left to think about God because he has been misrepresented to them by professed Christians and their creed. Nevertheless, as St. Paul explains, even the heathen have a longing for God and feel after him if haply they might find him. Doubtless in the minds of many people in every land, occasional worship of God is in response to the call of these higher organs of the brain. They cry out for intercourse with God, fellowship with him. The Lord consecrated people, begotten by the Holy Spirit, may have constant communion with God. Even in their business and in their pleasure, they have the Lord as their fellow or partner. They confer with him, respecting the proper course to be taken in everything. Such is the ideal condition. Happy are all who have this experience. They are God's saints. Only true Christians now have the privilege of prayer, with the promise of being heard and answered. These are only such as have repented of sin, who have contemplated their lives to God's will, and have Jesus as their advocate. When God created man, this craving of the highest organs of his nature was abundantly provided for. Man had unbroken fellowship with his Creator. But when sin entered, God broke off this fellowship and condemned Father Adam to death. During the Jewish age, that people had prayer privileges restored to them at the house of servants. Similarly, the church has prayer privileges, but as the house of sons. By and by, however, the fellowship between God and the world will be restored, by the rays of the great Messiah, Christ and his church, his body. At the end of the millennium, all who prove themselves unworthy of life everlasting will be destroyed in the second death. And those counted worthy of eternal life, having reached human perfection, will be restored to full fellowship with the Heavenly Father as Adam originally possessed it.